A very good morning to everyone. I welcome all the dignitaries, faculties, professionals, and my dear students to the Career Opportunities and Pathway webinar series, jointly organized by Victoria University, Uganda, and Ganpati University, India. We have eminent personalities joined today for this webinar. We also welcome all the dignitaries from Victoria University and Ganpati University who have joined us today. For today's webinar, Career Opportunities and Pathways in Ethical Hacking, we have with us Dr. Rakesh Vanzara, sir. He's an IITian educationist and passionate teacher with more than 21 years of experience in academics as well as industry. His research interest includes wireless networks, cybersecurity, IoT, and machine learning. He has published and presented several research papers in international and national journals and conferences. Currently, he is leading the Department of Information Technology at the He has also gone through extensive training in domain of cybersecurity by several organizations, including EC Council and IBM. Professor Vanzara got the unmatched teaching style and serving as a mentor to many students to achieve their dream. Upcoming, sir, we are also having Professor Menka Patel and Professor Shweta Dirgat, both having rich experience in academics, and they are associated with Ganpati University. I hand it over to you, sir, and your team. Thank you.
Right. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you, ma'am, for a nice introduction. Now, let me directly start the session. Ma'am, we are starting, right, straight away. Tell me, ma'am.
Yes, okay, please.
Fine, thank you.
So students will join as we begin with the session, and between students will join. Yeah.
Perfect. So, we welcome to all, and let me share my screen and I will tell you what is the planning of the entire session, and then probably we can start with one by one. So let me share my screen just a second. And I hope now its screen is visible to all, and this is the first slide that we have. Right, so that today we're gonna talk about something called ethical hacking, right? And before I jump directly into the hacking and the ethical, there are a few things that I need to make it very clear, So, the first question naturally in the mind of the student or any parents or any faculty is that why this topic is so important? What's the need to study this kind of subject? Is it really relevant? What would be the future? For example, this kind of questions that you have, I will try to answer that question. So what I will do is we are three faculty members who are going to cover this entire webinar. So the first thing is we will tell you the basics of the cybersecurity in very brief. Then in order to understand the cybersecurity domain in the details, our assumption is that you don't know anything about cybersecurity, and somebody who is also 12th grade students, they are also sitting in the audience. So we will tell you the basics of the computer networks. Once the basics get over, we will tell you what is hacking. And when it comes to the hacking can have two objectives. It could be for a good objective, or it has a bad intention, for example. So we will tell you what we mean by hacking, what types of hackers we have, right? And then we talk about the steps of the ethical hacking. Once this things get over, we will have some hands-on session for you. You don't require too much resources at your end. even the browser and maybe the device that you have is sufficient for all of you. So, you know, after 40-45 minutes of brief discussion, probably we will have a hands-on sessions where you will learn a lot of things, and we will show you a lot of demonstration so that you can have an idea exactly what you mean by hacking and how somebody get the information from you and like that, you know. I hope I'm audible, and let me start with the first slide. So the first question is, what is cybersecurity, right? So basically, a cybersecurity refers to the use of network architecture, software, and other technologies to protect organization and individuals from cyber attacks. So see, probably we have thought of that there could be a lot of attacks, but cyber attack is now nowadays the most dangerous. Even people are saying that now you know, work cannot be in the field, it's going to be in a cyber physical systems, right? So it's a very challenging area that we are targeting today, and I will just show you some live statistic which will tell you how many attacks are happening per second and like that, you know. So there are a lot of terms that comes across you. Somebody is talking about computer security, somebody is talking about network security, somebody is talking about internet security, but believe me, all are trying to say something related to a cyber security. Whether you talk, see, if you are an individual user, you are concerned about your computer. If you are an administrator of an organization or a company, you are concerned about the network security. If you are working as an ISP admin or in some big organization which is responsible to handle a lot of clients, then probably some of you might be thinking of internet security. But believe me, at all the stages, what we are talking about is basically cyber security. Now, there is a big challenge here. Cybersecurity should be required. It's not an optional one. You cannot ignore it, right? If you keep ignoring it, believe me, someday you get stuck in your work, right? So cyber criminals constantly hone their skills, advancing their tools and tactics. So what is required? When you want to protect, see, please understand, it is very easy to attack on a system, attack on a network, but it's very difficult to protect. The reason is that in order to protect the system, in order to protect the network, you have to ensure everything, every port, every entry point that you have in your system, your in network must be secured. Whereas as an attacker, I just need to think, if there is one thing is open, I can attack. So please understand, the defense is always difficult compared to attack, right? So this is what, with a secure infrastructure, you are not only able to keep your organization out of harm's way, you are able to unlock innovation and accelerate the business value. This is the importance that you have. Now, before I jump into the prerequisite, let me show you something. You know, I hope my screen is clearly visible to all of you, and let me show you some really interesting data, right? See, there is a website which tells you actually what is going on around the world, how much you know, attacks are happening in the real time. See, can you see here, this clocks show my local time, right? Maybe in your country the time could be different, but this is my own system's local time. If you can see this number, it shows that today how much attack happened, right? It's around 4,28,000, and see, every fraction of second it's keep increasing, and this is the real time attack map that I'm showing you. This is the important, right? This much attacks are happening every day, and this is just a two o'clock in India, so it's, we are on the half day, right? So similarly, let me show you some interesting statistic. You know, this shows the live map, and it shows the statistic how different kind of attacks are happening. You can move around and you can see any country, for example, you know, you can watch any country that you are interested in, right? And you can see how much attacks are happening, right, every second. This is the live map it shows, and the website that you can see is, right, Kaspersky. So probably even at home you can do this experiment. This shows the United States, right? So nobody is protected, and that's the reason why the cybersecurity is so important. Now, in order to understand the cybersecurity, friends, there is a requirement to understand, have the basic understanding of a computer network. I am assuming that you don't have any knowledge of a computer network, and so I'm going to talk about that in few minutes, and I will ensure that whatever the things required to understand a computer network, you understand it. What I mean by computer network is the way the machines are connected. Right, whatever the hardware is required, whatever the software is required in order to make interconnection, and that's what I mean by computer network. If just to make your understanding very simple, let me tell you, for example, Facebook. What Facebook has done, it has created a network of the people, right? But believe me, if I remove the internet from the backbone, there is no value of Facebook. It cannot survive without the internet, right? So internet is backbone. What I mean by internet or a network, it's an interconnection. When I say network, it's interconnection of devices. In order to interconnect the devices, each device needs to have an ID. Just aapko itna some, right? You need to just understand. In order to have a device connection, you need to have an ID, right? And that's what we mean by the device ID. And when I talk about device ID, in case of computer networks, it is called an IP address. It is called an IP address. So what is essential thing is my machine has to have an IP address. See, believe me, all of you have an IP address, right? All of your machine, because you are connected to internet, all of you have an IP address. I will show you one demo, which is very exciting. And I'm able to tell you what is your IP address, in fact, right? So I will show you just now. But this is what I mean by an IP address. So you understand what I mean by an IP address? It is a mechanism to allow my system to be network. If I want my machine to be in a network, it has to have an IP address. And believe me, all the IP addresses has to be unique in the world. There are different ways by which an organization can work with one IP, and internally it can have multiple IPs. There are a lot of techniques available. We are not going to talk about that. But this is what you mean by the basics of a network, right? There is also something called a MAC address, which is essentially called a physical address. In fact, in a terminology of computer networks, there are three kind of addresses. One is called physical address, another one is called logical address, and the last one is called the port address. See, these three things are very enough, and then we can directly jump to the next topic. Physical address is limited to your machine. It depends on your machine. Then I can have something called a logical address, which I called as an IP address, right? In fact, right now we are in a migration phase. There are two versions of the IP addresses. One is IPv4 and another one is the IPv6. We are in a migration. Probably 3-4 years down the line, we never talk about IPv4. We probably have IPv6. But right now, both coexist simultaneously. Then there is something called a port address. Actually, there are some models in the computer networks. If you talk about architecture or a software architecture, each operating system, for example, if I talk about Windows operating system or a Linux operating system, they have implementation of something called TCP/IP protocol suite. So this TCP/IP protocol suite have a different layer. I'm just telling you in 30 seconds, physical layer, data link layer, network layer, transport layer, and application layer. Friends, please remember what I said is physical address is given by your data link layer, IP address is given by your network layer, and the port address is given by your transport layer. Now, you know, the things that you need to understand is at transport layer, there are very two well-known protocols. If anybody says that I know the computer network, these two protocols are very well-known to that person. One is called TCP and another one is called UDP. These are the very well-known protocol, and this TCP and UDP ports are actually a transport layer protocols, right? And above transport layer protocols, what you have is something called application layer. For example, every day in the morning, let's say you open a google.com. So before you know Google, what you are writing is HTTP. So basically HTTP is a protocol, right? HTTP is a protocol which is working on top of the TCP. Each protocol has a specific port number. Well-known protocol has a specific port number where they are working, right? So there are two things that I am talking about. One is the port address, another is the protocol, right? So port address is given by your transport layer, IP address is given by your network layer, in the physical address, or you can call it MAC address, is given by your data link layer. Excellent. Right now, let me show you something live so that at least you can understand. For example, I request those who are having the device or a laptop, I request you can open up a google.com. Just open a google.com along with me, and there is a website. I think you are able to see my screen, right? There is a website called what is my IP address, right? What is my IP? You just click on that. And see, the way I'm clicking here, you click on that. In my case, because I'm behind the cyber security, I'm behind the firewall, it does not allow me to open this, but you can open it, right? So if you type this, it will work. What is my IP address? That will work in your case. In my case, it may not work because I'm behind a firewall, right? So once you click on that, I hope everybody is able to get an IP address, right? From that site, your IP address. Now in the chat window, let me put something for you. So I'm just stopping a presentation for a minute, and I wish you to click on one of the link that I'm sharing with you. Just be with me for a moment. I'm sharing one link with you, and I wish you to click on that. Just a minute. So I am going to a chat window, and Akshar bhai, chat window. Yes, it's there. So let me write. I hope every participant is able to see the chat window. There is a link. Yes, all the attendees, I request you to click on that link if you can. Yes, Menka ma'am, that is opening one form.
Yes, sir.
Right, it has opened a
form. It is loading actually. Okay. Yes, sir.
It has opened the Google form, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You cannot see the link. Raj, I think I have put the link. Again, I'm putting a link here. Again. Now, I think, Raj, if you can see the link. Yes, link is in the chat window where you have written the message. Just click on the link, or maybe you can copy that link and open in a browser. Just copy that link and open in the browser. Akshar bhai, aa bada chat nathi joi shakta attendees? Khali panelists mate tame nathi rakheli ne?
So everyone can actually see the chat that is open for all the attendees.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, yes. And but the thing is, the link which you have sent, it is for, you have sent it for all panelists. So
fine, ma'am.
So that is the problem. Please send the link to all panelists and attendees. Yes. Okay. Yeah, just a minute. We will just change it from here.
Now you can see, I think. Sorry, I forgot it. Now you can see, Raj. Yes, please. So just click on that link. Each one of you are requested to click on that link, and I hope you got your IP address also when you click on the what is my IP address. Yes, I request all the participants or attendees to write if you got your IP address. Yes or no? Don't write your IP address. I will show you your IP address. Just open the link, fill up the form. See, in the form intentionally, I have not given you any option. You have to agree or proceed. There is no negative is allowed, but this is just for a demonstration purpose. So I wish you to, I request all of you to agree on that form and click on the submit. And yes, thank you. I hope everybody got your IP address, right? Great. So So now I will share my screen again with all of you, and let me check how many of you have clicked the link. Great. Oh, great. Most of you. Great. Fine. So let me share my screen again. I think most of you have done it, but still, if somebody has left, please finish that form by the time I'm sharing my screen, and I want to show you what is your IP address from here. Right? This is a very basic experiment that we did, but this is what you need to understand, ki each machine is connected by an IP address. Right? So now let me show you. Someone's IP address is this. If you can see my screen, Menkamem, I hope my screen is visible, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if some of you are able to read this IP address, I wish you to write your name in the chat window so that, you know, you can see 197, someone's IP address is this, right? And it shows your location also, right? Maybe sometimes it does not show the exit location, but mostly, right? And probably you are using Mozilla or right 5.0, and or maybe you have a Chrome also, right? And maybe you may have a MI phone probably, right? So there are a lot of things that it talks about, right? Similarly, there is another person who is attending from this IP address, and you are using Airtel Uganda, right? That's your network. And your OS, it shows iOS. Hello. Yes, right? You must have checked your IP address, right? Fine. So this is all the details about you. See, look at. You click on the link that I've shared with you, and I got your details here. You can look at from which countries you are and from which IP address you have been connected. Yes? Great. So I hope I'm able to make this point very clear. Any doubt, then you can write probably in the chat window. And if I have shown you right IP, just I wish you to write down, yes, I have shown your IP correctly. Right? So, and if you have any doubt, maybe you can write somewhere. Okay, so let me go ahead now. Great. So let me go ahead now again. And let me show you something very interesting. So basically, see, this is your, you know, how to go come here. You can apply the command prompt, right? So when you type command, you will come to a screen like this, right? And this will help you to get your IP address even. So there is a command which is very well known, which is called ipconfig, right? On the Windows operating system. If you have a Linux operating system, probably some of you can write ifconfig. So it could be either ipconfig or it could be ifconfig based on the operating system, right? So if you write ipconfig, you will get all the details about your own machine, right? You will get all the details about your machines, right? So that's how you can use, I said, you can use ipconfig in order to know the IP address of your own machine, right? Now, there is also a command. For example, if I'm connected to some machine or not, there is a command called ping. What this ping will do? Ping will help you to check whether you are connected to some other machine or not. For example, I can ping like this, right? I can ping like this. And when I do this ping, probably, see, the most important thing is it shows me the IP address immediately. Right, see, for example, because I'm behind a firewall, it's quite possible that, but look at, I will change the domain name now. This is called a domain name, right? Whatever you are calling Yahoo or see, it's giving me an IP address, and that IP address is coming from my DNS, right? So I have given the domain name as an input. This google.com is called a domain name, yahoo.com is called a domain name. So I have given domain as an input. What I'm getting as a, it's immediately, it's giving me an IP address. And when you ping from your machine, in fact, those of you who have a machine, you can always apply this command ping, and you can try out, you can see how it works in your machine, right? So similarly, there is another very important command. We have started, let me remind you, we have started basics of the cyber security. I am talking about the prerequisite, which is computer networks. After that, we're going to start with what is hacking. Then we will take you to the ethical hacking, and then we will start with some practical exposure. But before I will go jump into that, I want to show you something, how IPs and everything is working. What I said, IP address is a device ID, which is required in order to connect a machine or a device into the network, right? Now, when I say trace RT is a command, right? And I can do trace RT for anything. For example, I can write like this also. See, I hope you are able to see my screen, although it is at the downstairs, but let me check. I hope you are able to, let me make it very clear first. Okay, then let's say I'm writing traceRT google.com, right? See the sequence that you are getting, right? First one is, this is the IP address of the Google. Now, what I'm trying to show is, I'm behind a firewall. I have my own local networks. And this 192.168.20.251 is called an IP address. And this is the IP address of my gateway. This is my router. And now my gateway has stopped my request going out, right? Because nowadays, you know, everything is happening online. So we have make it very secure. But if you are an individual user, you are not in company or organization network, you are able to do this, right? So when you apply this traceRT to google.com, actually what you can do is you can have all the possible path between your machine and the entire list of routers that you have, entire the list of devices that you have. See what I mean by the router or devices, believe me. Let's say, just for a moment, assume that, let's say this is my IP address. Then here I will get the list of the devices, because each device has an ID. You get the list of the devices which are connecting you and google.com, right? This is what you mean by traceRT. You are tracing a route from your machine to the google.com, right? So that's how the traceRT will work. So what I'm trying to explain you here is, because I am behind the firewall, right? My gateway is not taking me out of it. But the point is, if you are an individual user, you can always do that, right? So traceRT is a command which will give you the route. So let me again go back to the presentation, and then I will show you something very interesting, and then we can move to the next session. So this is what I talk about, basics of networks. I said you need to understand an IP address, you need to understand the port address. Port addresses are given by a transport layer. IP config is a command to know my IP address. TraceRT will help you to trace the route from your machine to the specific domain that you are targeting, right? For example, as an exercise, what I can tell you is, you need to find out an IP address of this website, right? Let's say, as an exercise, you need to find out an IP address of this website. What you will do? Yes, even you try to ping this, you will get an IP address. You write down on the, go to the command prompt, write down ping:// certifiedhacker.com. It will give you immediately an IP address of this domain, right? So for any machines or any domain you want to find an IP address, the ping is sufficient, right? Similarly, I already said traceRT. What traceRT will do? TraceRT will tell you, the complete route from your machine to the desired domain. Very true. Now, in the rest of the session, what we're going to do is, we are going to start what is hacking. Then probably we will be talking on, the types of hackers that we have, what kind of attacks are possible. And then we will be talking about what are the phases in the hacking. And then we are taking you to the lab part. Now I'm inviting my colleague Professor Shweta to share her screen and talk to you regarding what is actually the hacking and what are the types of hackers and all this stuff, and then we will move you to the laboratory. So Shweta ma'am, if you can share your screen. I have stopped sharing.
Yes sir, thank you sir. I hope my presentation is visible.
Yeah, visible ma'am.
Okay. So, good afternoon, all the students. I'm Professor Shweta Dharkar. And now I'll be discussing what is hacking. So basically, we can say in computing, a hacker is any skilled computer expert that uses the technical knowledge to overcome a problem. While hacker can refer to any computer programmer, the term has become associated in popular culture with a security hacker, someone who with the technical knowledge uses bugs or exploits to break their computer system. Now, as I said, hacking, so hacking is basically referring to activities that seek to compromise digital devices, such as computers, smartphones, tablets, and even entire networks. And while we're talking about hacking, so it is not only always a malicious purpose, but most of the time we refer hackers to be malicious people or who are doing unlawful activity or who are known as cyber criminals. Now, but there are some people who might be doing hacking to gather some information, like for doing spying and even for fun. Now, many think hacker could be a self-taught kid or a rogue programmer who is skilled at modifying computer hardware or software. And so it can be used in many ways outside original developer's intent. Now, as I said, hacking. So hacking is what we can say. It is typically in nature. It is a bit bad reputation, right? But hackers are also using psychology to trick users into clicking a malicious attachment. Now, as I said, hackers need to use some psychology. Now, see, this psychology or these tactics are known as social engineering. When RDV sir, Rakesh sir asks you that you have to click on the form, and then you clicked on the form, right? And then your information was gathered and we were able to see your information. So that is a skill where the hacker has to first of all do some social engineering and ask the actual victim on which the hacker is trying to do attack that to share their information. And when the victim shares their information, then they become vulnerable to the attack. Now I'll dwell onto some of the evolution of hacking. As nowadays we think hackers are always having a negative connotation. But in 1960, this hack term didn't originate from computers. Basically, it originated from MIT's Tech Model Railroad Club. What they were doing is they were a club members who hacked high-tech train sets in order to modify their functions. They were just doing it for fun. And so they were using toy trains. And then later on, they move on to computers. And then in 1970s, a new type of hackers came. Those were known as spreakers or were known as phone cracker hackers. Now, basically, these hackers were exploiting operational characteristics in telephone switching networks. But now these telephone switching networks are entirely electronic. In 1980s, terms like crackers came into existence, where more hackers were doing criminal activities, they were doing pirating of softwares, they were creating viruses and breaking into systems to steal sensitive information. Then in 1990s, again, these crackers who were now they had high profile activities they had started to do, like they were starting to steal proprietary softwares from big corporations. They were dumping radio stations to win luxury cars. They were launching the first computer worm and leading the first digital bank heist. So in 1990s, everything started getting online. So these activities started increasing. So in 2000s, this term came ethical hackers, where ethical hackers were basically hired. So we'll talk about the types of hackers, but in 2000s, the attacks like denial of service attack were done. When we talk about 2010, a very, very famous attack, which was known as ransomware attack, was launched. So this was about some of the history of hacking. Now we will see the types of hackers. So here you can see three little guys. One is wearing a black hat, gray hat, and a white hat. So you can see the there's a black hat hacker, there's a gray hat hacker, and there's a white hat hacker. So broadly, I'm classifying into three types of categories. That is black hat hackers. So these black hat hackers are also known as, they're also known as crackers, those who hack in order to gain unauthorized access to a system and harm its operations or steal sensitive information. Now, these black hat hackers, we say, are the hackers who are trying to do unauthorized access. Means they are trying to steal some information. They are trying to steal some sensitive information. They are bad guys. So when we talk about white hat hackers, they don't intend to harm a system. Rather, they are trying to find out weaknesses in a computer. Now, many organizations hire these white hat hackers just so that they can know the weaknesses or vulnerabilities in their own computers or in their networks, so that they can know if their hacking could be done in their systems, right? So basically, white hat hackers do this penetration testing and vulnerability assessments. Now, when we talk about gray hat hackers, so gray hat hackers are a blend of both black hat and white hat hackers. Now, they can sometimes do malicious activity for their fun and sometimes exploit the security weakness in a computer system or network without the owner's permission. And sometimes they could be helpful for finding out what are the loopholes in someone's system. So these are the three broad categories when I'm talking about. There are more other categories, like we have red hat hackers. Now, these red hat hackers are a blend of both black hat and white hat hackers. They usually work on the level of government agencies. They are finding out the top secret information. And then generally, they are doing anything that falls in the category of sensitive information. Then there is another term which was very popular, which is known as blue hat hackers. Now, blue hat hacker is someone who is outside computer security consulting firm. And what they are doing is they are trying to do bug test before a system is launched. Now, this Microsoft uses this term blue hat to represent a series of security briefing events that they do. Now, you might be knowing before launching any software, okay, if Microsoft is launching a software or any other company is launching a software, what they do is they create a beta version and they put out that beta version so that testing could be done. People can try and use that software, and this blue hat hackers find the vulnerabilities or the flaws in those softwares. And sometimes even after the launch of the softwares, you might be knowing that patches are given. That those patches are basically trying to cover up the loopholes that were there in the software. Okay. Then we have another type of hacker which are very popular. Those are known as script kiddies. Now I would wish that all of you would act like a script kiddie from today onwards. And this script kiddie is a non-expert who breaks into computer system by just using pre-packaged automated tools, like the tools we have shown you. Those were just simple tools and more tools you can use, so that what they can do is they can break into someone's system, like their friend's system or any of the family member's system, and then they can show off that I know hacking, right? So these are the types of hackers. So basically, they are doing very small attacks. So as I said, when I talk about attacks, so broadly, there are two categories of attacks. First one is passive attack and second is active attack. Okay, when I'm talking about passive attack, so a passive attack is the attempt to learn or make use of information from the system, but it does not affect system resources. Now, these passive attacks are in the nature of eavesdropping or monitoring of the transmission. The goal of this attack is to obtain information that has been transferred. Now, here you can see there is this Bob and Alice. Now, they both are trying to communicate. And they are using some internet or maybe some other communication facility. Now, this attacker Darth here is trying to read the contents of the message from Bob to Alice. Now, see here. The attacker here, Darth, is not doing any kind of changes in the content of the message. Darth is just trying to eavesdrop the message, or is just trying to monitor the transmission. So basically, Darth could be thought of as an unauthorized party. He's trying to gain the access to the message contents, and he's trying to do maybe say wiretapping or capturing of data or illicitly just copying of files. So this is a passive type of attack. Now, it is very difficult to identify that this type of attack has happened. Okay, so next type of category is active attacks. So basically, an active attack attempts to alter system resources or affect their operations. Basically, active attack involves a modification of the data stream or creation of false statement. So here you can see Bob and Alice are trying to communicate as in the last image. Here our attacker Darth is capturing the messages coming from Bob to Alice and then storing it. And then what Darth is doing, now Darth is later replaying this message to Alice. So here we can say that there can be different types of active attacks, like this one as I showed you. Here the replay of the message is done. But there are other attacks like altering the system resources or affecting the operations of the system when two people are communicating. They are trying to do some malicious activity and they are not letting them to communicate. So the different types of attacks in active attack could be masquerade attack, where Darth would be acting to be Bob and then sending the message to Alice. Then it could be replay as it is shown here. Then it could be modifying the message. Darth could just copy the content which Bob is sending and modify that message and send it to Alice. Then it could be denial of service, means it is not letting Alice to reach to Bob. So these are the types of attack which can happen when we are talking about active attack. So as I said, active attack represents opposite characteristics of passive attack. Whereas, as I said, passive attacks are difficult to detect and there are many measures available to prevent those passive attack. On the other hand, it is quite difficult to prevent active attack. We cannot prevent active attack because there are wide variety of potential attack vulnerabilities are there. So they could be used and active attack could be launched. So instead, here our goal when we're talking about active attack, the goal is to detect active attacks and to recover from any delays which is caused by them. So here we have discussed about types of attack. So two broad categories of attacks were passive attack and active attacks. Now let's start with steps of ethical hacking. I hope I didn't go too fast.
Even if that is the case, you can ask the students whether they have understood or not by just raising their hands.
Yes, if someone is having any doubt, then you can raise your hands and just give me any question in the QA section. So, yes. Soumya, I think you are having any doubt?
We can unmute him. Akshar bhai, please unmute him.
Ryzen karo na? Ryzen nahi.
Okay. I guess he has left. There must be some technical issue. Ma'am, you can continue.
Okay, thank you. So I hope my presentation is visible.
No, ma'am.
No, it is not visible. One second. Okay. Actually, I exited the presentation and then.
Soumya ko allow karna uska rise hand hai.
It's okay, Akshay bhai. We'll take it later.
Okay.
Are you able to do it, ma'am?
Hello.
Hello, Shweta ma'am, where you stuck? What happened? Let me start. Hello. Shweta ma'am. She's there or not?
Yes, ma'am, I'm here. Yes, actually it got disconnected. Should I present when I was trying
the presentation?
Yeah, yeah. Shweta ma'am, you can now share your screen.
Ma'am? Yes. Yes, ma'am.
If you have a problem in presenting your screen, should I present?
No. Is it visible now?
Yeah, it is
visible. Just make it present.
Okay, I'm so sorry.
There is a question, ma'am, if you can handle, where do we place man in the middle? So there is a question, and from that slide, probably you can explain him, where do we place man in the middle? That is a question now, from you.
Yes, sir. Thank you. This question is from Maya, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. It's from Soumya.
Okay. So, Soumya. Okay. So here, if you're talking about man in the middle, so that is a kind of attack. The man in the middle here, if we talk, actually that is an attack in Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm. But I'll tell you what is man in the middle. Now, suppose here we see that Darth is here. And here he is acting to be man in the middle. Now what will happen that when Bob is trying to send any message to Alice, so what Darth will do, Darth will capture that packet. Okay, so capture that packet and modify the content of the packet and then send it to Alice. Okay, so yes, so it is just like a replay message done here. Okay, see, the Darth will capture the packet, modify the content and then send it to Alice. So that could be thought as a man in the middle attack. But when you are knowing about Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm, so when Bob and Alice are trying to come to a point where they are finalizing a symmetric key between them, so that time man in the middle would share one key with Bob and share another key with Alice, and then whatever the message contents are coming from Bob, Darth is able to see. And whatever the message contents are coming from Alice, again, Darth is able to see. So Darth is acting to be a middleman. Okay. So I hope I was able to answer your question.
Yes, we also have one more question from Isa Muhammad. Okay. He is asking, what is the differences between hacker and a cracker?
See, as I said to you, when we said that there are two types, there were attacks like in 1990s, there were crackers, right? So crackers basically are trying to crack a key to any proprietary software when you're using some software which is proprietary. Right. So if you are not purchased that, so they require a key. So if you have that key, if you break that key, okay, then you can use that software to the full extent. So those could be thought of as the crackers who are trying to crack the passwords. Right. But basically, if you're talking about hackers, they require more skills, like they should be having skills about the networks. They should be having skills about social engineering. They should be having different type of skills about different types of operating system. So hacking is a different activity, where all the steps from gathering information to launching an attack and maintaining the access on that, maybe the system or maybe the network or maybe the website. So that is hacking. But when you asked about crackers, so crackers are basically people who are trying to crack some password, or as I said to you, they are trying to crack a key to the proprietary software. So I think you understood the difference between crackers and hackers. Okay, do we have another question?
Yes, ma'am. You have solved most of the questions. Okay. You may please proceed, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So Next, when we have already talked about types of attacks, we have talked about types of attackers, or we can say hackers. So now we will move on to next, that is the steps of ethical hacking. So as we discussed, there were three types of hackers: black hat hackers, white hat hackers, and gray hat hackers. And when I said white hat hackers, they are the good guys. So we call them basically ethical hackers. So the steps for any type of hacking would be the same, but here we are covering the steps of ethical hacking. So there are basically five steps in which, and this is like a life cycle. So it's rotated again and again. So first step is reconnaissance. Second step is footprinting and scanning. Third step is gaining access and elevating privileges. Fourth is maintaining access. And then last we have covering tracks. And when we talk about ethical hacking, it is also reporting. So basically there are these five steps. So first of all, when I'm talking about reconnaissance, so this reconnaissance is the phase where the attacker is gathering information about the target by using active or passive means. So as we talked about the attacks, so they could be as a means where attacker is trying to gather some information. So we can use some Windows command line utilities, some open source information gathering softwares, like we did ipconfig, then we did tracer. So those were the Windows command line utilities that we can use for reconnaissance. Now there are other tools which can be used for this process, like Sublist3R, InSpy, Web Data Extractor, Maltego, Google Docs, and there are many more. So basically this phase where the attacker is trying to gather information, in this phase, the attacker should be good at social engineering. So as I said, attackers or hackers have to be good at social engineering so that they can use their tactics to find out a victim and find out the vulnerability about them. For example, basic information. Like I'll tell you a simple example. If you want to find out the password of your friend, what would you do? What would you try? First of all, if you want to try out some passwords of your friend's email ID, so what would you try? So you might try his birth date, or you might try the anniversary of their parents. Okay, so this is the information that you use. Okay, that comes basically from social engineering. So first of all, this in this phase, what we are doing is we are trying to get basic informations about the victim on which we are trying to do attack. So the next step is footprinting and scanning. So in this process, the hacker or the attacker begins to activate a probe to target machine or network for vulnerability that can be exploited. Basically, the tools here in this process are HTTrack, website copier, Nmap, Angry IP scanner, HPing 2, HPing 3, Nessus, Nexpose, and etc. So like similar tools like this could be used. So we'll be showing you an example of Nmap probably today in this webinar as well. So what we are trying to do is we are trying to map the network. We are trying to get the information about IP addresses, open ports in the target machine. We are trying to find out the vulnerabilities in the network in which we are doing the attack, or the organization in which we are trying to exploit. So basically, this is where you are trying to scan the network. So this second phase is footprinting and scanning. Now, third phase we have is gaining access and elevating privileges. Now, once you know what are the vulnerabilities, what you can do is you can try to exploit it, and then you can enter into the system. So the first step here would be trying to find out the vulnerabilities of the system. And the primary tool that we use for this process is Metasploit. And there are other tools like John the Ripper. Now this John the Ripper is a tool which is used for cracking passwords. And then we can use OpenWAS. OpenWAS is a tool which is trying to find out the vulnerabilities in a network. Then you have SQLMap, then WAPPT, and Canvas. So these are the tools that could be used for gaining access and elevating privileges. Next is maintaining access. So in this process, the hacker has already gained some access. So in the earlier phase, that is gaining access and elevating privileges. So as I said, elevating privileges. Yes, I should get into that as well. Now, once you have gained an access, right? So what is the benefit of you gaining that access? You should be having more privileges than others. Now, you might be knowing there is a root type for every file. So
for every file, when you're talking about Linux operating system, you have a root, you have a group user, and you have a other user, right? So when you are other user, means you are using that file, so you might be able to just read a file, you might not be able to write into that file or execute a file. But if you elevate your privilege, means you become a root user, okay, once you have gained the access to the system, what you can do, you can become the root user, and then now you can read, write, or execute that file. So this is gaining access and elevating privileges. Now, when I said what is maintaining access, so it is the process where the hacker has already gained access into a system. After gaining access, the hacker installs some backdoors in order to enter into the system. So as and when he needs to enter into the system, he is going to use that backdoor. So again, Metasploit could be used as a tool in this process. And what a hacker or a attacker does here, so he installs some Trojans. So Trojans are again like backdoors, which will allow the attacker to enter into someone's system and launch some attacks. And then he could install some viruses. He could install botnets. Now, these botnets could be used to launch distributed denial. So install keyloggers. So now these keyloggers would log every key that you press. So it could be the passwords, it could be your usernames everywhere. Okay, so this type of utilities or the malicious program codes could be used by the hacker so that the hacker can maintain access to the system or the network in which he has already gained access. So the last step is covering tracks. Now, basically, this covering track is an unethical activity. What the hacker does is hacker deletes the log of all the activities that he did during the hacking phase, and he disables the auditing, clearing logs, modifying logs, clearing the registry files, removing all the files that could lead to him. Okay, so this is the activity where the hacker will try to remove all the tracks, okay, and cover them so that nobody can reach to him. Okay, and the last step, as I said, it is ethical hacking. Then reporting is the last step for finishing the ethical hacking process. Here, the ethical hacker compiles a report with his findings and the job that has been done, that the tools which are used, the success rate of how many vulnerabilities that he has found, the exploit processes that the ethical hacker has used. So all that would be stored in a report, and that report could be given to the organization who has hired that ethical hacker to do the attack. So again, I'll show you the steps. The steps include reconnaissance, then footprinting and scanning, then gaining access and elevating privileges, and then we have maintaining access, and then lastly, covering tracks. Okay. So if anybody is having any doubt, then we can just have that questions. Otherwise, we'll directly move on to the lab session.
We are having one of the doubt in chat section.
Yes, ma'am.
How do you do that, your computer system being hacked or cracked? How do you protect your system from being hacked or cracked?
See, what you can do is, if you want to prevent your system to be hacked, you must first of all stay away from social engineering activities that somebody is trying to do, right, with you. So you don't have to give them information. Now, sometimes even if you are not giving information, your system might be giving information, right? So what you can do, you can use some good firewalls. Those are intrusion prevention systems. Like firewalls you can have, you can put up a proxy so that nobody can know about the IP addresses that you have used. You can close the open ports that are not used, right? So these way, what you can do is you can safeguard your system. And then you should not be clicking on the links, web links, where phishing could be done. Right, so that way you can safeguard again from hacking. Okay, and when you when you asked about cracked, so as I said, cracking a system is not done. mostly cracking of a password is done, and cracking of any proprietary software is done. So if you don't want your software to be cracked, so you should try and remove all the vulnerabilities or the open loops that are there in the software. See, what happens when a computer engineer, if they are not having much knowledge, what they do is they try to copy the code from here and there. So when they are doing copying of that code from here and there and putting up and creating a website or a web app or a software, so in that there are some holes or vulnerabilities that are left. Okay, so that should be done. First of all, checking of that should be done. Okay, I hope you understood what I was trying to explain.
Great, ma'am. Moving towards the next question, which we have got in the question section. What should we do when your device is hacked?
Okay, once your system is hacked, now first of all, how would you come to know that your system is hacked? So there are anti-malwares, like antiviruses are there, anti-malwares are there, who would try to remove all the adwares or the trojans or the viruses in your system that are there, right? That have come through some possible ways. So what you can do is, once you know that your system is hacked, so you should look for the registry, you should look for the files which have been modified. And when you're talking about pen drive or basic simple things that you come to know that there are viruses in that, so you have to scan, or formatting would be the last option that you can do. You can format your operating system at last when your system is hacked.
Yes, ma'am. We have no more questions.
Okay. Yeah. So we will move on to the lab session. I think Menka, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I have stopped sharing my screen already.
Okay. Now let me share my screen first. Okay. Is this visible?
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
Yes.
Okay. Good afternoon, all. As you have already seen, the basic concepts of networking, and with that, the stages of ethical hacking. Now, our aim is to how we can do this, all the stuff, whatever that you have already seen in the different concepts, sir and ma'am has explained you, like you have seen ping, tracert, IP config. So how we can use that all the stuff in case of ethical hacking to gather the information. And other than that, we'll see some more tools. Using that also, we can do some sort of the steps which we have seen in the ethical hacking. So as we have already done the ping and all, so we'll directly move on to the one of the tool, and it is very interesting. It is actually available online. It is called archive.org. First of all, just try to understand what exactly the use of this, and then after I'll show you the life of the same. Basically, this archive.org is used to gather the information of website from the older versions. Like every time, see, as you have seen many times, like the websites, the updation in the websites are there, maybe in terms of designs, maybe in terms of information or in other stuff, right? So that all the that older versions of that is also having some sort of information. So if somebody wants to somebody try to find it out or gather the information related to that website, what that website contains, the information as well, when that was, the launch first time, that particular organization has launched the website first time and all. So all the histories related to the website we can see using this online tool called https archive.org. So let me show you how exactly you can do it. And with me, if it is possible, as it is online available, you can, even if you have joined this with your mobile, you can open it. let me just put this link onto the chat box, or else just you can write it down, type this archive.org on the browser. Okay, now it is available. That website is open, archive.org. All of you got it? If you have any doubt, or if you don't get it, just write it down that in the chat box, so we can I can solve that problem. Once you have this here at this place, Wayback Machine, here at this place you can enter the URL for which particular website you want to see the history, how it was looked like earlier. So for example, all of you know, you are right now attending this webinar, and this is hosted by Ganpat University. So let me write it down here, ganpatuniversity.ac.in. Okay, you can see the graph, right? From this, you can understand, see the first line for this at 2005. This is the time when this website was launched first time. Okay, and here at the bottom part of it, the entire, you know, the calendar is available from January to December for a respective year. And it shows some highlight dates. Here it is in March, on the 11th, on April, on 18th. Right at May 10 and 11, what it means, these are what the time actually as and when the website was modified. Okay, so if you click here, let's say on this place and on this particular snapshot, just click here, it will just redirect you onto the Ganpat University website, how it was looked like earlier. You can have some sort of detail. See here. It was looked like this on this date, 4th February 2006. Then if you just move ahead a little bit, then it was looked like this on 2nd May 2006. The design of Ganpat University is like this. By clicking on this, all some of the links and all, you can gather the information. And let's say here at this time in 28th August 2017, it's looked like this. And nowadays, for today, let's say on 11th May 2020, it is like this. I hope everybody are getting me. What I'm trying to tell you, see, by doing this archive.org, web.archive.org, you can have the information related to the websites, or we can say the history of particular website, how it was look like, so means in terms of design, in terms of information. So when it is talking about reconnaissance, that is what the very first phase of ethical hacking. So this is one of the way to gather the information from a target website or a target network, right? Other ways are there, as you have seen ping. So using that, you can get the information, that is what the IP address of the particular machine, then tracer, even you can use to find it out how many hops are there between to reach onto the target network, right? Likewise, this is one of the way to gather the information from the target website. Other than this, there are the various ways to find it out the and the different ways to find it out the different types of information from the target network, but this is what one of the way to get it. I hope everybody are doing with me. So if you have any query, please tell me. Okay, so now this is one of the lab which I want to share with you related to the information gathering, and that is what is there over here. So you can even try to see your the website of your university here for your exercise. You can do one thing: open this again, archive.org. If you have already opened it, at Wayback Machine here on this place, just write it down the website, the URL of your website, your university's website, and you can check how exactly it was look like before 3 years or 4 years or 10 years. And also, you can check it out when it was launched and all the detail related to the particular website. Okay, so this is the first lab task. Fine. Now the next one is related. Next one is very interesting also.
Hello.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Yes.
Ma'am, just for better understanding, could the URL be copied in the chat section also? So sure, that if they have missed taking it, they can do this for Victoria University as well.
Okay, ma'am.
Menka, ma'am, otherwise I will do you continue, not an issue.
Sir, are you going to copy?
I'm pasting that.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you, sir.
Yes, it's there in the chat window, so everyone can get that link which to use.
Okay, sir has pasted the link. You can try it for your university too, so you can see how exactly it was look like earlier. Okay, now let us move on to the another lab or the practical. See, this is, as I already told you, this is used for information gathering. There are the many ways to gather the information. This is one of the way. Other ways, like ma'am has already told you, it is about social networking, right? So if you're posting most of the data, what you are doing every day and all the stuff on the social media, it would be possible to gather the information by the hacker. So if it is possible, never, and if you want to protect yourself from this type of malicious activity, you can avoid to post some private information onto the social media. This is one of the way to protect yourself from the some sort of malicious activity. Now the next lab is very interesting. If you remember, yes.
Menka ma'am, there's a question. Yes. What if once a website was online and now it is offline? Will it archive or will it show the archival information?
Okay. You can try that website on this archive.org. If it was registered properly at that particular time, it is possible to have some sort of archive information for that particular target website. I hope you are getting my answer.
Yes, definitely.
Okay, thank you. Now, the next is the experiment. And for that, if you have your laptop, if you're connected with the laptop, you need to download actually one tool. And it is actually a very interesting one. Before that, I need to connect you for the second lab with the phases of ethical hacking or the steps of ethical hacking, which you have already done. Now, just go back. Let me go back on the place on this diagram. See, reconnaissance, we have seen the demonstration for reconnaissance. It is also known as information gathering, right? Now, the next step is what? The footprinting and a scanning. So, for the footprinting, the meaning of footprinting is you are trying to get the information of the website without creating any kinds of log onto the system. Means actually there are the different ways to do a footprinting. One is like a active one, another one is like a passive one. Means when it is active, you are putting your all the you are trying to getting the information from the live website. But sometime it is not appropriate one to get the information from the live website or to do a footprinting on the live website. So instead of that, what hacker can do, what pen tester can do, just create the mirror image of the website, store it on the local machine, and then try to get as many information can that pen tester can get it, and then try to modify it. If is there any vulnerability in the particular website, then that programmer can try to modify it and make it, try to make it secure one. Okay, so let me show you the lab for that. And for that, you need to go onto the browser. And you need to download the web the tool called HTTTrack website copier. Let me show you from where exactly you can download it. This is the link. Let me put it on the chat box. HTTTrack.com. Just click on it. Sorry. Just a minute. You can click on this HTTTrack.com. It will just redirect you on this particular page. And from here, you can download. Just go on to the download. Here, there are the different, you know, versions of HTTTrack are available for the different platform. If you are using a Windows machine, from Windows 2000 to Windows 10, you can download this particular version of it. If you are using Windows Vista to Windows 10 with a 64-bit, you can download it from this. Likewise, different versions are available. Just click on it. Like I am having Windows 10 64-bit machine, so this particular version is appropriate for me. And then once you download it, okay, install it. It is very simple installation, so you can try it even with me. Just click on to the next. After, you know, by reading this, then after I accept the agreement, and then click on to the next. The place where exactly you want to install this particular tool that you can define, and then next, again next, and install. It will start the installation. And then the finish. After installation, it looks like this. Now the next step is what? See, again, just let us recall what exactly we want to do by doing this. This is one of the tool to perform a footprinting. It can be very difficult to perform a footprinting from the live website. And this is because of that, you can create by using this, You may need to, by doing this, you can create a mirror of the website for the footprinting. And then, as a professional ethical hacker or a pen tester, you should be able to mirror the website of a target organization. So this lab is for footprinting, in which we are creating the mirror of the website and then try to analyze the entire website. Okay, so just what you need to do, click on to the next, and here write it down the project name. Let me write here, it is a demo project. And there's no need to write anything in the project category. And here in the base path, you can just put up, keep it as it is. By default, it come where exactly, based on that, where exactly you have stored this, installed this software. And then click on to the next. Now, here...
Meenka ma'am, the screen of your software is not visible. Instead, this HTTrack website copier is only visible. From you started the installation from there, yes, to new project, basically new project at least. Now,
yeah, now visible.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, let me start it again from the first one. Okay, after installation, the tool is look like this. Then click on to the next, and here you can write it down. The name of project, it is demo project, then project category, no need to put up anything over there. And then here by default, the path will come. Just click on to the next. And here at this place, you can write it down the URL, which you want to, for the website for which you need to create the mirror image. Okay, so let me write here. certifiedhacker.com, and here preferences and mirror option set option, by clicking on this and just click on to the scan rules. Here you can add what type of images you need to include, what part you need to exclude. Okay, I need to include all the different types of images, all the different types of zip, and all the different types of audios and the videos, everything. So I need to click here on all these places. Fine. So that all the different extensions come in this box, and it, when it try to create a mirror of the original website, it include all this stuff in the, but a mirror of the original website, and click on to the OK. And now here click on to the next. And after that, no need to do any kind of changes here, and then click on to the finish. You can see here it start processing. It takes a few minutes. Meanwhile, let me show you. If you remember which website we have written to create a copy, certifiedhacker.com. Just I've moved on to the browser and written here certifiedhacker.com. This is what the actual website, it looks like this. Okay, now is this visible? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, it is. Thank you. Thank you. It takes a few minutes. You can try it
in your machine too? As over here, you can see the images are there. It takes some time. Okay, it is end of it. Now you need to click on browse mirrored website. When you click on it, it gives me the mirrored website. And here at this place, even you can see the path. It is stored in my local machine. Right? So this is what the website. We have seen already this website on through the browser. That is what the actual website. And now this is the mirror image of it. If you click on any of the page, let me click here. Let's say it is about portfolio. If you have created a mirror of entire website, it gives me that page too. Okay, so by reading this, all this stuff, or by checking this, all this stuff, by analyzing all this stuff, I can do a footprinting. This is not a live website. This is the mirror of the website, but whatever that live website is, it is exactly looks like this because we have created the mirror of it. Okay, even you can just click onto the contact. See here that all the informations it is available on this, then back on the next page. Let's say it is about destinations. It gives me this, all the details about us, contact us. Okay, so what is the advantage by doing a mirror of the website? The advantage for the pen tester, and it is, instead of, you know, analyzing the website live one, because it is very difficult for the pen tester to do it, as we are talking about here ethical hacking. So ethical hackers are nothing but the pen tester, and the job of them is try to get the vulnerabilities from the system. So by doing this, it would be easy for the ethical hacker to get the vulnerabilities from the website, or to gather the information from the particular website, or we can say the footprinting, right? Because this is what about this, the main purpose of mirroring the website is for the footprinting, to get all the details by analyzing this mirrored website. Okay, I hope all of you are understood with this, how to create a mirror of the actual website. Now, let us move on to the next lab. Any question up to this? Am I going faster or it is okay?
We see no questions on the panel, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. So, I hope all of you are doing the same with me. Now, the next one is the very interesting lab, and it is related to, you know, sniffing. So if you remember, you have studied two types of attacks. Ma'am has explained you two types of attack.
active and a passive attack. Right? Passive attack and the active attack. So the passive attack is nothing but try to gather the information, but not actively, passively. Means the attacker is try to monitor the system, nothing else. So for that, as you have studied network also, the fundamental of network, one tool is available called a Wireshark. And using that, we can capture the traffic from the network. So you can download that particular tool from the, let me write it down. Let me show you that website also. From where you can have it. Yeah, this is the place from where you can download it. Wireshark.org. Let me copy the link into the chat box. Yeah, ma'am has already put up the link into the chat box. That is wireshark.org/download.html. Just in that also, when you read that link, redirect you on this particular page. And here you can see again the different versions of Wiresharks are available. For the Windows 64-bit, you can download from here. For Windows 32-bit, you can download from here. For Mac OS, you can download it from here. So when you, in my case, it is 64-bit, you can just click on this and download it. It takes a few minutes.
For downloading this software, ma'am, students should ensure they have a good connectivity issue, right? Or else they lose the connection.
Yes, ma'am.
Even one of the student, Fred, is asking the same thing. He had downloaded the software and then he lost the connection. So I guess, Fred, you must ensure that you are connected to a proper connectivity.
Yeah, but in this case, this softwares are, you know, with very few MBs. So it is possible even if you have some sort of weak connection, not a poor one, but somewhat weak connection, weaker connection.
Right, ma'am. Otherwise, if all they cannot perform with us, probably we can demonstrate them and later on, you know, once their download get done, they can do those experiments.
Yes,
so I think we should go ahead.
Yes, yes, sir. Okay. By this, you know, once you finish this downloading, when you install it, it open. Okay. You can open the app Wireshark. Okay, and here, very first app that you need to take care when you are using a Wireshark, it is where, from where exactly you need to capture the packets. See, so on this place here that all the list of, you know, the connections are available. So the connection which is active in your machine, in that case, you can have a kind of, you know, the measurement. So from that you can understand. This is the place from where exactly, or this is the place from through that particular port my network is active. So I need to select that first of all. So as I've double click on it, it start the capturing the packets. How it capture the packets? So you can just keep this live and you can try to communicate with other system which are there in your network, or
if you are not connected with any of the network, but yes, you all are connected with the internet, and internet is nothing but one network that everyone knows, right? So right now, these all the packets which you are able to see onto the screen, that all the packets are from the internet. The websites which I am using, you can see here the different websites I am accessing from here. So that and the Wireshark is working in the background, that all the packets are captured by the Wireshark. And here you can see now on this red button, you can stop the capturing. After capturing all the enough packets, what you can do? Stop the capturing of new packet, and you can start to analyze this all the packets. Let me show you some of the fundamental part. Like, this is what the source address, this is what the destination address. When you double click on the packet, it gives you this all the detail. If you remember, sir told you about Ethernet, that is what the MAC address. So here you can see this is what the MAC address, it looks like this. Then you can click here IP version 4. Sir has already discussed about IP version 4 and version 6. So here you can see Internet Protocol version 4. So when you click on that, you can have all the detail of that particular packet. Then the protocol, if you remember, TCP and UDP, two protocols that you have seen, right? So yeah, that UDP is nothing but user datagram protocol. So the detail of that is available over here, and what type of data that is captured by or that is carrying by a particular packet, that data is available over here. So when you click here on this window, on this place at the bottom of this, you can see these are nothing but the hexadecimal form or the hexadecimal numbers of all the packets. And at this place, you can see some of the characters that are visible, because the connections which we are using, from that we can have this type of information. So by doing this, we can do the we can capture the network traffic. And once we have a network traffic, then after being a hacker, we can try to gather the information from that also, and being attacker also to gather the information or gather the packets, and then after we can analyze the packet, and from that, in the data part of that packet, we can see what type of information that packet is captured and carry out. So let me show you with the help of Wireshark how we can capture or how we can sniff the username and a password which is used in a particular network. So again, let me start my Wireshark. I don't want to save this all the packets. If you want to save, you can click onto the save and save that all the packets in your machine. I don't want to save it, so I'm just going to click onto the continue without saving. Okay, now it has started the capturing. Now at the same time, I'm going to going on to the browser and write one website, the name of website called techpanda.org. See, this website is asking me to enter email ID and password. I don't have correct email ID, but let me write here admin@gmail.com. This is what the email ID and the password, let me write here this. Okay, it is not visible to us. So click on to the submit. Even though it is incorrect, the email ID and password, that is not a correct, but our aim is just to see how to do a sniffing. Now let us move on to the Wireshark, stop the capturing, and Wireshark is providing one facility called a filtering. So as in a few minutes or even in a few seconds, Wireshark is able to capture all the traffic which is going on in the network, right? And network in the network, so many packets are moving. So I can filter it out. As I know, I have accessed this particular website, and the protocol for this website is HTTP. So in this filter, I can write HTTP. Hope it is visible. HTTP, and click Okay, now you can see here, Wireshark is also providing this. See here, the list of protocols that all are HTTP. Okay, and this is what about information. So I need the information related to what? I need to sniff the username and a password, right? So here, this is the packet post/index.php. When I double click on it, and then after, I need to move at this HTML from URL encoded. When I click here, you can see here the email and the password which I have entered onto the techpanda.org. Okay, so with the help of Wireshark, we can capture the traffic of the network. See, you are not able to capture the traffic from my network, but you can capture the traffic of your network, where exactly you are there. And then after, you can analyze the data likewise. So in this case, we got use email ID and the password which we have entered onto the website called techpanda.org. Why it is possible to get it here? The reason behind that is techpanda.org is not a secured website. You can see onto the website. See here, if it is visible to you, you can see here, not secured at this place. This website is not secured. What does it mean? The packets captured, the information, whatever you have entered on this particular website, it is traveling with the plain text. Means in a readable form. Okay, we are able to read that username and the password. Here, it is admin@gmail.com and password was abc@123, right? Here we have entered, when we have entered, it was like this. But when we have captured it through the Wireshark, that data are in the plain text, means in a readable, understandable format. The reason behind that is this website is not secure. So you can even, one of you had asked the question, like how we can check whether it is secure or not. When you access the website, you can check the security of the website by looking this also. If it is not secured website, and if it is asking you to enter some sort of your sensitive information, like your username, password, or a bank detail and everything, never provide that type of information on not secured website. So for that, what is requirement? So here you can see if it is a secured one. So how you can identify whether it is secured or not? If it is not secured, then straightforward it is written here, it is not secured, right? But if it is secure, let me show you in case of Google. Here you can see the lock, right? So this, by looking this, you can understand it is the secured one. When you click on that, even it show you the certificate. When you click on that, it open up the certificate. When you move on to the detail, it provides you all the security information of that particular domain. With that, if you click on the last tab called a certification path, it provides you who has issued this certificate and all. Okay, so our aim right now, just to understand how we can identify whether it is secured connection or not. Otherwise, the sniffing is possible, which we have seen just before a few minutes. Okay, so if it is a lock, if lock is available, means it is a secured one. So at least you can open up it and check it out whether it is secure or not. Or here, when you click on it, it shows connection is secure. And if it is not secure connection, it mentioned in the URL itself, it is not a secured connection. So this is how you can identify whether that particular website is secured or not. And based on, and then once you decide it, then after provide your personal detail and everything onto the website, so you can protect yourself. Okay, by this kind of attacks called a sniffing. This is called a sniffing. This is the example of passive attack. Okay, I hope everybody are clear up to this. If you have any doubt, you can ask me, and then after we can move on to the next lab. Any doubt up to this?
So there aren't any questions raised in the panel. You may proceed.
Okay, thank you. And the next one is, as we have seen, again, let us move on back, go back onto the web, this diagram. Right, here you have seen a scanning of the network. By scanning the network, you can have the information related to the port number, web. How many ports are open, how many ports are closed for the different services that sir has already explained you. So now we'll see the demonstration of the same. So for that, let me provide you just a link from where you can download the NMAP, the tool which is called the NMAP. It is available in the presentation also. For the scanning, we can use the tool called NMAP. Okay, so you can download it from nmap.org. Okay, just, and this is the place from where exactly you can download it. Let me put it in the chat, so at least you can even download it later. Fine, nmap.org. From this you can download it. The use of nmap tool is scan the network and try to get the information related to the port. Okay, so let us move on to the nmap. Okay, this is what how exactly nmap looks like. Let me show you. For the Windows, don't get confused. When you download it for the Windows, it is Zenmap GUI. Okay, and this is how exactly looks like. Here you can write it down the target machine, the name of, or the IP address of target machine. Now let me demonstrate one thing. In the first lab you have seen that sir has explained the ping command. Using that I can have the IP address of particular domain. So let me show you one thing. If I ping on certifiedhacker.com, I can have the IP address of that, right? That is 162.241.216.11. Okay, now let us do the NMAP on that. So using NMAP, we can scan the target network. Here, our network is what? 162.241.216.11. Okay, this is the IP of a particular machine called a certifiedhacker.com. Now, if I write it down that in the target, that is 162.241.216.11, and the type of scanning which I need to do that is ping scan. Let us do the ping scan and click on to the scan. It is started to scan the machine, and from this you can see here it is host is up, means this target machine is on. Okay, now to get the information related to the port, let me do another type of scan, that is
Okay. TCP port scanning. You can see here it is giving me a list of open port. These all are the open port which are discovered from this particular host, that is 162.241.216.11. These all are the different ports which are open. Okay, now this is what the nmap output. You can click here, that is nmap. Okay, let us do one more type of scanning. And let us see what type of output we'll have. Yes. Again, it is providing a list of open port. Still it is scanning. It is not end of the procedure. Still the process is going on. It gives me the list of ports which are open. Once the process end, I'll show you the next step. Okay. It is done. Okay, here at topology, you can see you are here from the local host, that is mine host. From that you have here a green, means this is the connection where I have done the scanning. Okay, and from this particular host, I got this list of ports which are open. What does it mean? See, as in the houses, windows are available. If windows are closed, everything is secured, it is fine. But if windows are open, it is possible from that part, somebody can come inside the house and do and steal some sort of information, some sort of things which are available in the houses. Likewise, in case of network, when ports are there, if ports are open, it is possible for the attacker to get access through that open port into the system and then try to get the information from that. So how you can protect yourself from a kind of thing? So for that, as ma'am has already discussed, the firewalls, the and using that firewall, you can protect yourself. You can on the firewall. So as and when unnecessary or the malicious connectivity, somebody is try to get into the system, firewall stop that unknown person to or unknown packet to come into the system. So this is about nmap. With the help of nmap, we can do lots of things, different types of scanning and try to get different types of information, like which particular port is open and all this stuff we can do with the help of nmap. You can see here in the profile, there are the list of different scanning options are available, right? So you can click according to what scan that you need to do. Based on that, it can give you the information. Here you can see this all the detail we got with the help of nmap. See the detail. Let me show you some of the things. Yeah, from here, this all are nothing but the open ports. Then after, here you can see the services 21/TCP. This is what 21, 22, these all are nothing but the port numbers. 26, 53, 80,
right here you can see HTTP you have learned today. You have got many times HTTP. So here 80 port number is for the HTTP service. It is hypertext transfer protocol for the web. It is used, right? So the port number for that is 80. Likewise for the FTP, it is a file transfer protocol. This is the, for this particular service, the port number is 21. So these all the ports and the status of that port, you can see it is open. Here also it is open. And the port, here it is SSH. It is a secured connectivity. So that connectivities are secured with the DSA and RSA. These all are nothing but the secured, the terminology related to the security. And many other stuff also, the signature algorithm, the public key algorithms. These all are the details. So when you learn this course, you can have this all the details. And you can understand this all this stuff by yourself when you learn this course in detail, as this is just a trailer part of your course. This demonstration just we have shown you. Okay, here you can see this is the first tab called nmap output. Another tab is port/host. Here you can see this all the ports which are available, the protocols used by this particular port, that is what the TCP and the UDP, two protocols mainly. So this all the services, these are the services. So this all the services are using TCP port, TCP protocols. And here it is the status of it, whether that particular port is open or closed or the filtered. So these two are the filtered one. Means that two are not possible to connect with, but rest all are open to connect. Fine. This information we got for the this particular target called 162.241.216.11. And this is the IP address of target website called certifiedhacker.com. Likewise, you can try for a different website. If you don't know the IP address, not to worry. Now everyone knows a ping, right? So in your command prompt, just do a ping and the website name. By doing that, you got an IP address, and then you can use nmap to scan the target website to get the information related to the port number. You can scan entire websites. And you can have this type of all the list. Once you have this, then after the next tab is what? After scanning. See, after scanning, the next step is what? Gaining access. So how you can gain the access? For that, you need to have information related to the open ports and all. Once you have this information, there are the different techniques. There are the different tools available. Using that, you can try to get into the target network. And once you have the access of that particular network, you can get the information from the target network, or you can do some sort of testing on the target network. As we are doing here ethical hacking, our aim is just to do a legitimate activities. Our aim is to just to do a penetration testing. We are not here just to do some sort of harmful activity onto the target websites. But these are the different ways that we have seen till now to get to understand the phases, like reconnaissance. Using that, you can gather the information, then a footprinting and a scanning. Once you do this, see, these two steps are very important. Once you do that two steps, then after, it is possible to perform this next three phases. That is what? Gaining access, maintaining access, and covering the tracks. Covering the tracks is not a ethical activity, actually. So it is about maintaining access and the gaining access and elevating privileges.
Inka, okay, ma'am, if you can go to last slide.
No. Sure, sir.
Yeah. It's time almost.
Yeah.
Yes, great. Yes, ma'am, we have to conclude now. Probably you can explain this slide if somebody is interested in entire course. As you know, Menka ma'am has already said, it's a trailer part only. So entire movie is still remaining, and we have a long way to go. There are a lot of things that we can demonstrate you practically, but you know, this is just a beginning. And our assumption was that you don't have any idea of even the IP addresses, right? So if somebody get into the course called Ethical Hacking, what you're gonna learn is the topics that we have listed. Each topic has a lot of details to work on. So, you know, starting from footprinting, scanning networks, enumeration, vulnerability analysis, system hacking, malware threats, sniffing, social engineering, session hijacking, hacking web server, SQL injections, hacking wireless networks, cryptography, and maybe, you know, IoT security part and the cloud security part we're gonna cover. So that's how your entire course will be constituted. And we will do lots of hands-on as a part of this ethical hacking course. So now I think, Remy ma'am, we may have around 1 minute if somebody has a question. Otherwise, we did from our side. Thank you, one and all. If you have any question, you can raise.
Thank you so much, sir. I thank Professor Vanzara, sir, Menka madam, as well as Shweta ma'am. So let me just check if we are having any questions in the QA section. And in chat, it has been a lovely, wonderful session, sir. In fact, I was regularly observing. Thank you for patiently hearing to all questions and replying to them, responding to them. So I guess we are having one chat.
Yeah, certificates. What we can do, let me answer that question. Actually, our course will prepare you for a certificate called CEH of a EC Council. So if someone will do this course, definitely you can go for a CES, Certified Ethical Hacker of an EC Council, or maybe you can also go for a certification of a CompTIA. But we recommend EC Council, right, which has a global acceptance, and you know, it's acceptable anywhere in the world. So after attending this course, you can definitely go for the Certified Ethical Hacker examination. It has two parts. One is the CEH, which we call normally CEH, and then it has a CEH practical. But for CEH, practical CEH is the mandatory. So you can start with CEH. That's it.
Thank you, sir, for clarifying that as well.
Okay, thanks.
Yes. So I hope, with whom do we have on the panel? Bill sir, I hope this has been a very informative and exploratory session. Tomorrow we will be seeing you all at same time, 11:30. And tomorrow we are having session of basics of Python. So it's basically very excellent programming language, which could be very beneficial to all of you, to the beginners as well. And we are looking forward. Okay, so we are getting feedbacks over here in the chat box as well. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. See you soon tomorrow at 11:30, same time.